Council.
I'd like to call this regular council meeting of March 14th to order. Looking for a motion to, we snuck in just under the wire. I'm just going to lock that door. Looking for a motion to adopt the agenda. Councilor Inglis, Councilor Nixon, all those in favor, motion is carried. Is there any minutes of the, sorry, is there any business arising from the council minutes of February 28th? Sorry. We need a motion to adopt the minutes of the regular council meeting of February 28th. Councilor Inglis, Councilor Brothers, all those in favor, motion is carried. Now, is there any business arising from those minutes of February 28th? I don't want to do anything out of order. No announcements from the mayor other than happy birthday to Alex Cooper today. Who should be out skiing instead of being here.
Yeah, it looks really pleasant out there.
It's obviously that work environment doesn't allow you to have your day off, full day off, with, to ski on your birthday?
No.
Okay. Next item is recommendations from Committee of the Whole, Indemnification Bylaw. Councilor Brothers.
Your Worship, that Indemnification Bylaw 2139 be read first, second, and third time.
Motion by Councilor Brothers, seconded by Councilor Nixon. Any discussion on the motion? Councilor Nixon.
Your Worship, I thought we had this in place. I remember talk of it back in about 2013, and I guess we did not follow up on that. That's a good idea.
Any other comments on the motion? All those in favor? Motion is carried. And bylaws. Section 219. Councilor Brothers.
One at a time?
Yes.
One, with a report prepared by the Manager of Legislative Services dated March 13, 2017, in respect to the registered Section 219 covenant, we received as information.
Motion by Councilor Brothers, seconded by Councilor Nixon. Discussion on the motion?
I'll admit to being unprepared here. I see there's been an update, and I was sitting in my bed reading this last night, and it seemed like it was light, so that was my question. And basically, has anything changed since we saw this last time? My apologies here.
Gorse, pigs, and fowl.
Your Worship, nothing's changed. They've just completed the covenant as requested in previous council meeting.
Mm-hmm. So no detail changes, no?
No big changes, okay, thank you very much.
Any more comments on the motion? All those in favor? Mm-hmm. Motion is carried.
Part two, the official community plan amendment bylaw 2134 be adopted.
Motion by Councilor Brothers, seconded by Councilor Sauls. Discussion on the motion? All those in favor? Motion is carried.
Part three, the zoning amendment bylaw 2137 be adopted.
Motion by Councilor Brothers, seconded by Councilor English. Any discussion on the motion? Councilor Nixon.
Your Worship, I was at the local food initiative annual general meeting last evening, and they were very pleased that this is going forward.
Okay. Any more comments on the motion? All those in favor? Motion is carried. Next is the South Revelstoke Area Diagnostic Inventory. And Mr. Selby, you have a presentation for us?
Yes. Thank you, Your Worship. The subject study areas consists of the South Revelstoke properties between the Columbia River and the South Revelstoke proper boundary there. Following Council's support in principle for the South Revelstoke Diagnostic Inventory on January 24, 2017, and confirmation of the 30,000 grant from the province, we now have the final terms of reference for review and approval. The final terms of reference has been updated to include clarifications and a public engagement component. Thank you.
All right, I can move forward to 10A. The terms of reference for the South Revelstoke Area Diagnostic Inventory of Planning, Service Delivery, and Governance be approved.
Motion by Councilor Dukes, seconded by Councilor Nixon. Discussion on the motion? All those in, yes.
Sorry, Your Worship. Just, as far as this plan now with a diagnostic inventory, this is not going to make recommendations back to the CSRD or to the province about governance and land use. It's just really looking at what's there, who's on septic, and just all the details of the land use that's out there. Is that correct?
Yeah, from my understanding, it's just, it won't consider or present any specific options for boundary expansions or restructuring.
And that would be a later plan.
That could happen later, in later phases.
Okay, thank you.
By approving this, or we're approving the financial, and that's going forward to, okay. All right, just want to make sure everybody's clear of what we're talking about. Any other comments or questions? All those in favor? Motion's carried, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Selvig. 11A.
Your worship, I may have a conflict on this, as I'm the coordinator for emergency social services, so I'll step up.
Part one, that the Revelstoke Area Emergency Management Program Regulatory Bylaw 2171 be read first, second, and third time.
Motion by Councilor Brothers, seconded by Councilor English. Discussion on the motion. Councilor Nixon.
Your worship, I'm glad to see that this management committee's up and running again and partnering with the rest of the community. I think it's good with what's happening regionally, with mudslides happening on the highway, so it's a news again that we have a good solid plan in place.
Yes, it's actually, when you start sitting down and going through it all, it's pretty interesting, all the ways that we are looking after the community in case of emergency. And emergency week, when is that coming up? Do you know?
April.
Yeah, I think it's coming up fairly soon, and I think it's always a good time to be reminding people about their responsibilities in an emergency, and I think we'll be hearing lots more about that when emergency planning week comes up. Motion is on the floor. Is there any other comments? All those in favor? Motion's carried.
Part two, that the terms of reference of the RAEMP Management Committee be approved.
Motion by Councilor Brothers, seconded by Councilor English. Discussion on the motion. All those in favor? Motion's carried. Don, do you want to look to our councilor? And this next item is a vacation rental.
Yeah.
The next two.
Next two.
And Scott is declaring his conflict of interest because it is. And Mr. Silva, you have a presentation. This is 1920 Hay Road.
Thank you, Your Worship. The purpose of the application is to rezone in order to permit vacation rental use. As proposed, the subject home consists of a four-bedroom principal suite and a one-bedroom secondary suite. The principal suite is proposed to be used as a vacation rental. As noted in the report, there are a number of properties in the area which have already rezoned permit vacation rental use, have an approved B&B license, or are in the process of obtaining approval. I'll leave it there for your questions.
And there's no issues with the parking on the side?
They're within the bylaw requirements. Yeah.
Anybody? Yes.
Bring this forward, Your Worship.
Okay. First motion.
That the application to rezone Lot 5, Section 23, Township 23, Range 2, west of the 6th Meridian, Kootenai District 10, NEP 80224, 1920 Hay Road, from single-family residential district R1 to single-family residential vacation rental district R1V be approved.
Motion by Counselor Hinn, second by Counselor Nixon. Discussion, Counselor Brothers?
Just a question for Mr. Selby. Mr. Selby, there's an indication that if it doesn't go through as a vacation or secondary suite, it's going to be a B&B. Will there be a public hearing with respect to a B&B? Is it the same process?
No, there's no public hearing. It's just a business license, and if they meet the requirements, then it's approved.
Okay, and secondly, there's an indication here that the RCMP have noted concerns with parking along Hay Road. Is it related to this particular property, or is that just in general business?
That's just in general. We haven't had any reports specific to this property from the RCMP that we know of. And it's just, and in general, I think those, once they get approved for a vacation rental and are licensed, are generally more cautious on making sure they inform their clientele to not bring trailers or large vehicles that won't fit within their parking, because otherwise they run the risk of losing their license. And I should just note, B&B does involve a review from the building and fire inspector to make sure their life and safety concerns are met.
Okay, thank you.
Counselor Lando.
Your Worship, just a general question of staff. It's my understanding, according to the report, that if this is approved, they would then add the secondary suite in there. And is it still true that bed and breakfast and secondary suites are not compatible? So it would be to move forward as a bed and breakfast as a whole home bed and breakfast?
Yes, that's correct. Okay. So they've applied for the secondary suite, but they don't want to complete it until they know they have approval for vacation rental, because otherwise they don't want to complete it, because you're not allowed a secondary suite for the bed and breakfast.
Okay. And why is that?
It's a good question.
Why is that?
Why can't you have a secondary suite with a bed and breakfast license? It seems to me more appropriate to have a secondary suite with a B&B. I don't know. It just seems appropriate to me.
I know there's a good reason, but I can't think of the top of my head.
Sorry to put you on the spot. I thought of it earlier. I should have come.
I'm sure it'll come to my brain eventually here, and I'll let you know maybe after council meeting.
Okay. I see the proponents are here, and I would encourage the proponents to meet with the neighbors and talk with them and tell them what their plans are. This can be a little more of a contentious area, and a lot of neighbors are very concerned with what's going on in the neighborhood.
Understand.
But good luck.
Thank you.
Sorry.
And Your Worship, today we're just approving the application.
Right. But the idea is that eventually this is going to go into the secondary vacation rental, and it will be the subject of a public hearing. Because it has to be a public, there has to be a public hearing.
Mm-hmm. Well, Your Worship, I'll bring that forward after you.
Yeah, just as it doesn't say on here that there's a public hearing, but there will be a public hearing for it. Sorry, Councilor Nixon, do you have anything again?
Yeah, just Your Worship, I did have some concerns from people in my neighborhood, I live up there, about parking issues on Hay Road. So I think, you know, we need to be really sensitive to how many places are going into that Aspen vacation area, and staff to come back to, if I could ask for staff to come back to us with how many are showing up as requesting these legal suites, because we need to get a pattern there, because there's a real pattern and theme of big long skidoo trails up there.
And I think that the intention is that after the cap and we get some breathing space, the report from council is going to be, report from staff, I should say, to council, is going to be talking about all these things. And some of the questions I'm going to have is densities of vacation rentals in neighborhoods and things like that. And that's when we are going to have to start, again, taking vacation rentals to the next level and coming up with a whole other series of criteria. And that may be one of them. So that's a council decision to make.
And And further to them, it's just the parking. The parking is what starts annoying the neighborhood.
All right. I'm a little bit concerned that we're getting a little off track of this motion that's on here, so I'm going to pull it back to what we're talking about.
Just a question for staff, just following up on what Councilman Nixon has said. I just think it would be helpful if when it comes to a public hearing, we get some idea of that area, where all the, I mean, if they could just do a Google map and just pinpoint where we have all of the applications and what has gone on with dots, so that we know where we are. It'd be helpful for us in terms of parking and what's going on.
Yeah, and I've actually discussed that with our GIS technician to start working on that, and it's definitely something I think would be helpful for staff, the public, and council.
Great, thank you.
Okay, back to the motion on the application. Is there any more, oh, sorry, Don, you have
No.
We're like this, though.
Yeah, it was, you're right.
Any other comments on the motion? All those in favor? Motion's carried. Item two.
Thank you, Your Worship. I'll bring this forward as well, that application zone 2016-59 be kept in the queue for rezoning at council's discretion upon adoption of a two-zone vacation rental zoning amendment bylaw.
Motion by Councilor English, seconded by Councilor Sells. Discussion on the motion. All those in favor? Motion's carried. And we're into 2297 Airport Way now, and Mr. Selvig, you have a presentation on that?
I do, Your Worship. So this is a reapplication to rezone in order to prevent vacation rental use of a full home which consists of four bedrooms. The previous application from 2016 was defeated on May 10th after a number of public submitted letters and or spoke in opposition to the application at the public hearing. Staff have also received a complaint indicating the vacation rental use remains in operation and the property continues to be advertised on Airbnb and Revelstoke Vacation Rentals. No RCMP complaints or related enforcement that we know of to date.
Okay, see if anybody wants to put a motion on the floor.
I'll bring the motion forward, Your Worship. Thank you. That the application to rezone 2296 Airport Way, Lot A, Section 23, Township 23, Range 2, west of the 6th Meridian, Kootenai District Plan 6539, from Single Family Residential District R1 to Single Family Residential Vacation Rental District R1B, be approved.
Okay, and that's 2297. And is there a seconder for that motion? Councilor Brothers. Discussion on the motion. Councilor Brothers.
I'd just like to ask a question of Mr. Selvig, if he does know that. What has changed since May of last year such that a second look would be, there would be something different to the second look and council's point of view and that kind of thing? Because what I'm concerned about is that we push this through and you know, the same thing is going to happen again because it's exactly the same situation.
Yeah, nothing's changed from the application. It's the same drawings as far as I remember, and it's still four bedrooms. Nothing's changed that I know of. It's just they waited their 6 months before coming back again to reapply.
Councilor Sells.
Your Worship, it appears from our notes that are here that this is carried on as a vacation rental. So I'm wondering about enforcement. Are we able to enforce? Or I guess my question is, why is this still carrying on? And then they want to bring it back and say, hey, we've been doing everything that you've asked us to do. We want you to rethink this.
And I guess I'll jump in and answer that because I have been thinking about this, the whole vacation rental issue. And our attitude here at City Hall is that we want illegal vacation rentals going through the process. And this this couple here, I guess they disagreed with the council's decision, and they waited their minimum amount of time and have reapplied. Anybody that, as far as I'm concerned, and this is not an official position of council or city hall, but my attitude is that if people are in the queue and they are going through process, they should be allowed to continue to operate. When it comes to council table and the council decides to turn it down, a lot of these vacation rentals have people that are in, that have booked holidays that are coming here, and do we want to, on the next day after being turned down, do we want to tell them that they now have to stop operating? And I think that anybody reasonable would say no, they've made commitments, people are coming here and they're spending time on their holidays. There should be a certain amount of time. The real question is that after the season or a certain amount of time, we're expecting those vacation rentals to stop. So that's kind of the way that I've been explaining it, and it, to be fair, is that because we want people going through the process. So I'm in a roundabout way, I'm trying to answer your question, and they have reapplied, and in my mind, that would allow them to continue till council made a decision. What we're being asked right now is, do we want to reconsider? And I think the right question is that what's different? Why would we would reconsider? I think that there are some factors with this home here. One is that it's a setback away from its neighbors. There's lots of parking. It looks to be a good vacation rental. The real problem arose and with how the community reacted, the neighboring community reacted, and council voted accordingly. The question you're being asked now is do you think that all of those comments warrant this coming back and going through another public hearing process? Councilor Nix.
Your Worship, I do not think this warrants going through another public hearing. I think that neighborhood told us loudly and clearly that they do not wish to have this vacation home in their neighborhood. I think on paper it looks good, it should fit, but we gave the neighborhoods a voice through zoning and public hearings, and I don't support this going forward.
The only thing I would say in response to that is this appears to have come up early on in our sort of looking at vacation rentals and what we saw and what we heard and that type of thing. I don't want to encourage people to keep taking another kick at the can because it doesn't make any sense. But on the other hand, I mean, this came up and was turned down in May of 2016, almost a year ago. And I'm inclined to think, well, maybe there's something else that we should hear. Having heard so many of vacation rentals, and maybe this is a different situation. So I'm inclined to put it through.
Well, and that's exactly what we should be doing. It'd be good for council to be giving the reasons why it should be going through or not. Councilor Lando.
Your Worship, question for staff. I'm wondering how our queue is working and looking right now. We have 125 room limit, and I just was operating under the assumption that we had a big wait list, and I'm wondering how this one is back at the front of the line again.
From last I looked at it, I believe everyone is within the cap, and we have no applications outside the cap, but I could have changed in the last couple of weeks, but by no more than one or two applications, so it's really close.
We're coming to the end of the cap, and that doesn't mean that people have to stop applying, is that they could be going through the process and getting in the queue of having, being the next ones that are available, and when this report comes back to council, may in its wisdom say, you know what, the cap was just an arbitrary number that was picked, and everything is going fine, and we are going to raise that cap, or we're going to stop working. That's going to be a council decision to make when we start going through this, this vacation rental report that's going to be coming. Council Brothers.
Is there any way that we can adjourn this one and get the input of what the public hearing, I mean, the comments of the public hearing last time around? So, because I can't remember this one, I really can't. Maybe I wasn't present.
The dates of the public hearing are noted in the report. Council could, if they wish, circle back into the online minutes of that May meeting and review the comments then. I don't think we'd bring them forward as part of a new application. You know, maybe they are no longer relevant. Maybe this person operating for the since May without approval have proven to some of the neighbors that they're not wrong. And in, with respect to taking another kick at the cap, keep in mind that it's $1,800 to apply as well. So people are going to think twice about doing that.
And since turned down, Mr. Selvig, did you say that there was one complaint on this property since it was turned down?
That's correct. That we're aware of.
Okay, I'm just going to take a few more formal questions, and I'm going to ask a procedural question to Mr. Shippo. So, Councilor Lundy, you had your hand up?
Sure, yeah, just a comment. I've been in this house. I went on a PNCS, did a tour, sorry, eco-home tour, so I went there, so it sticks in my mind as to where it is. I understand the layout of it. I understand the arguments that it is fairly well-suited because it's got a fair distance between the neighbors and everything. However, I, as a result of having been in the house, I also do remember the public hearing very clearly as to what the, you know, the public's objections to it. And you know, we've, you know, this whole process in my mind is, for better or for worse, is designed to solicit neighborhood input, and I really don't think that's going to change. Sure, there's a good argument to say it's, you know, got lots of tons of parking, it's fairly private, but I just think that the neighborhood input is going to be the same, and I don't see how it could have changed significantly. So.
Councilor Nixon.
Your Worship, same owners reapplying to come and ask the same question. If they had come and asked the same question and brought four letters from neighbors that supported them and said, yep, we support them, then I would consider them.
Councilor Sol, do you remember?
Yes, I did, Your Worship. And the complaint that they had through Mr. Salvig is just a complaint that they were still existing. Is that correct?
Still operating.
Still operating. I have mixed emotions. And the reason why, I mean, I'd love nothing better than to say, yeah, we should give this another kick at the cap. But I do recall very clearly the neighborhood up in arms over this whole thing. And from my perspective, this appears to be a good area for vacation rental and for that. By the same token, if the neighborhood doesn't want it, where do we draw the line? So that's my concern at this point.
Any other comments? The motion is this rezoning application be approved. The next motion is scheduling public hearing. All those in favor? Against? Motion is denied. Would you let our councillor in, please? We are on to development services. This is a development variance application for 1953 Aspen Crescent. And you have a presentation for us, Mr. Sawyer?
I do, Your Worship. The purpose of this variance is to reduce the minimum corner lot width requirement from 16.5 meters to 15 meters in order to subdivide the property into four lots. Here's the legal plan showing the proposed four lots. Um, The requested variance is considered minor in nature and would permit the subdivision to maximize the number of lots while still meeting the maximum density permitted. I'll leave it there for your questions.
And it's because of the corners?
No, the recent bylaw change in November 8th, added a width for corner lots. They changed the width from 15 meters to 16.5 meters. Because basically every corner lot actually has a larger setback, side yard setback on that side street of 3 meters. So the purpose was to basically give every lot the same developable area by increasing the lot width by 1.5 meters. That makes sense?
Yep. Anybody prepared for the motion on the floor?
Yeah, I'm going to bring it forward. The council approves development variance permit application number DVP 2016-18 from Park Hill Investments Limited and gives notice of their intention to consider the issuance of development variance permit number DVP 2016-18 for 1953 Aspen Crescent to vary the following section of zoning bylaw number 1264 to vary section 714B to reduce the minimum lot width for a corner lot from 16.5 meters to 15 meters.
Motion by Councilor Hicks, second by Councilor Sulz. Discussion on the motion. Councilor Nixon?
Your Worship, does this set a precedence, or does this become just the variance for this particular law?
Well, I guess if people could be looking at it and saying, well, now I can do mine, but I think still it's a development variance and it has to come to this table and has to be approved. I think that what we are trying to do in this day and age is increase densities here and there and create more housing and try to keep housing as affordable as possible. Mr. Solvig.
Yeah, if I could speak to that. So this, if it's a new subdivision, I think it would be a different case, but this is an existing subdivision that was done back when the requirement was 15 meters, so I think it doesn't set a precedent, whereas if it was a brand new subdivision they're requesting that could potentially set a bit of a precedent. Yeah, this is a different case.
Thank you.
Okay. Any more comments or questions on the motion? All those in favor? Motion's carried. Correspondence is looking for a letter of support for Jill Shearing to sit on the Fish and Wildlife Compensation Program only for Councilor Nixon.
That a letter be written to support Jill Shearing in seeking an appointment to the Fish and Wildlife Compensation Program Columbia Board as a public representative.
Motion by Councilor Nixon, seconded by Councilor English. Yes, Councilor.
Question, but perhaps for Mr. Chabot, is this something we normally do, and why do we do it for this individual and not for everybody?
Nobody else asked.
Well, it just seems of some concern to me. I don't know Mr. Shearing, and that's probably everybody else does, but I don't, and he's not a city employee, and I have nothing against it, except I'm just wondering whether it's appropriate for City Council to give these recommendations. That's the only concern that I have.
Yeah, Your Worship, I never did take the opportunity to look at the application criteria. I'd be surprised if it required a support of a local council. It's sort of basin-wide, and you're looking for folks, and it might be somebody from the East Kootenai. It might be abnormal to do so, but I don't think it would be improper if council is familiar with Mr. Shearing and feel that he'd do a good job of representing not only the interest of Revelstoke, but the program across the region as well.
Councilman?
I can speak to that. Giles is a biologist that works in the community of Revelstoke, and he also does some work with the Squaxa Nation on the river, and I think he would do a very good job of representing the park area, but also for the good of the whole Columbia River.
Councilor Brothers.
I put my former lawyer hat on, and I just worry about exposure and liability and recommending somebody for a job in the event. But I guess it's not a job, it's just a, it's just a...
Sitting on board, yeah.
Yes, okay.
Councilor Schultz. Your worship, I know Mr. Sherring through search and rescue and a very outstanding individual in the community and great support for the community. I think he would be the perfect person to be sitting on this board, and I would endorse this.
Councilor Mendo.
To echo Councilor Schultz's statement, I've known Mr. Sherring for a number of years and through his involvement with SAR and various other community initiatives, including being on the environment committee in the past. And I know a lot of work the regional land compensation program does is important, and there's a lot of value to having a local person provide input here, since it is a basin-wide initiative. In terms of concerns about something going wrong for liability for recommending the wrong person, I just don't really see that. I don't have a concern for that, so I'm willing to support this.
I'm trying to think of somebody else who had their hand up. Councilor Nixon.
No, I was just going to say someone in the environment committee.
Councilor English.
I would lend my support to this letter as well. I've known Mr. Sherring for a number of years, and he would do a wonderful job representing us.
Any other comments? All those in favor? Motion's carried. Barusco Practical Road Waterline Repair. Councilor Nixon.
Your Worship, just to refer this to staff to start a research file, which I'm sure they've already done, and to bring back a report of where this neighborhood improvement will fit into the asset management program.
And I think that report should also include other options of how this project could get done. And this may be a, may go back to the neighborhood as a local area initiative. Because we have to be careful of the implications of what this is. And we could be getting hundreds of requests like this. Motion is to refer back to staff for more information and options. Is that reasonable?
Yes.
I'm looking for a seconder for that motion, Councilor Schultz. Discussion on the motion, Councilor Nixon.
Just a question for staff. I see Ms. Penny Page Britton is here, and she brings a report to council every year on our water quality. And just any thoughts on this?
I've worked on the annual water report in the past, and I don't know any further information about this than what I have read in the package.
Okay. Mr. Chabot.
Yeah, Your Worship, staff looked into this. Anytime we receive a letter of concern as to the quality of the water, we take that complaint seriously. Staff have done some initial investigation of the situation there, and I think are convinced that it's more an aesthetic concern as opposed to a health concern. Certainly a similar situation would exist in many other areas, and I think as part of anticipating the council might want to see something more thorough, we were going to undertake some water quality tests from the residents in that neighborhood and from others as a cross-reference point, and they look into the age of the lines, the availability of alternatives, and so it won't be a difficult task to put together a report for council to consider this request. And part of the conversation was, is this one of those ones that you say, well, maybe this is a local area service, or at least, you know, maybe this is in the financial plan for renewal in year 5 or year 8, or do we have a concern that compromises water quality?
Does anybody else have a hand up or any comments or questions on this motion? The motion is to refer to staff to come back with a report and options. All those in favor? Motion is carried. Thank you. Community communications, anybody have any comments on the Parks and Rec Culture Aquatic Center month-end reports for February? Business license summary for February 2017. The text steering committee minutes of January 25th. Councilor Randall.
Yeah, just an update. The committee is going well. We've had a couple meetings now. I'm really happy with the caliber of people who have joined up in the committee, including a variety of people with experiences. I know that the tech coordinator is down in Vancouver at the BC Tech Summit this week, and I think probably two other committee members at least went down there to it. So I did attend the BC Tech Summit last year, and it's a really good opportunity for networking. There's a lot of government there, and then there's also a lot of private industry, and you can sort of sign up ahead of time for networking meetings. And I know Carolyn was indicated she was going to look into that a little bit. There's a lot, the provincial government seems to be putting a lot of emphasis on this, and there's a lot of funding opportunities. So I'm looking forward to hearing now what everyone on the committee came up with down there. I think it's a really great opportunity, and I'm just happy to report that, and from my perspective, things are going well, and this is moving forward and making progress. So.
Beautiful. Councilor Nixon.
Your Worship, I just noticed in our business license summary that we have a performance circus coming to town in July at Queen Elizabeth Park. Interesting.
Already got my application in.
Is that you, Dr. Von Hooligans?
Finally, I've been drowned out. Any questions other than my application to the circus from the media?
None from me, Your Worship. And I wish you well in the circus.
I may run away. Birthday boy?
I have a question, and I don't know if Scott has to leave the room. It's about the Airport Way vacation rental, and I just wanted to ask you, like, clarify some of your comments, Mark. So I don't know if I can do that with Scott here or not.
I'm happy to leave. Scott,
or you could do it after the meeting.
I could do it after the meeting.
Yeah, that would be
perfect. Or she prepared to speak myself.
Yeah, well, we're just going to have a short meeting here afterwards, and then you can just give me a phone call, or I can call you, Alex.
Okay.
So I put one on Canada.
Sorry?
No, I can do that. I was just thinking maybe I want it on camera, but no, I'll call you after. Yeah.
Well, I've already said it on camera.
I know, but I can ask you again. Anyways, I'll call you later after the meeting.
Robert?
Yeah, thanks, Your Worship. Just a point of information. I didn't know about the circus coming. And as you know, we haven't announced it, but I'm working on getting the snowbirds to come and do an air show in Revelstoke. And as of yesterday, the date is July 26th.
Awesome.
And does that conflict at all with the circus? And because we may have a lot of folks, like the park is one of the areas that we can actually assemble a lot of people. Is there going to be a conflict there?
Was it the 26th or the 29th for the circus?
Circus is the 21st, actually.
21st for the circus.
And gone, or just one
that
day?
Day.
One day license. One day.
Super. Thank you.
Okay. Motion to terminate the meeting. Councilor Inglis, Councilor Sells, all in favor?